have here the 2012 World Championship of Public Speaking DVD, and this has all the contestants, the final nine contestants from 2012, and also the winner. So if you're interested in viewing this, let me know, and I can check it out to you. The other thing I wanted to mention to you was, as you learn to speak, when you look at your manual, especially if you're a beginner with a confident communicator, there are different things that they focus on every week. This week for me is going to be vocal variety, and you can observe vocal variety in a number of different areas. This weekend, I went to the All County Music Festival for my son. And what it is they take the musicians that audition and pick the best out of the county and put on a performance. In 9.5 hours, you would not believe the type of music that they perform. But as I was sitting there listening to them, first they had on the 9th and 10th graders, and then secondly they had on the 11th and 12th graders, what pops into my mind but Toastmasters? And why did they do that? Maybe because I was trying to prepare for vocal variety. But as I listened, I noticed what was different between the 9th and 10th graders and the 11th and 12th graders. The 9th and 10th graders were great. They put on a performance after only 9.5 hours of practicing together in 3 days. Yet, the difference was the 11th and 12th graders, they were quieter. They were louder. They didn't play at points. They were resting. Just like in vocal variety, you need to make your voice louder, quieter, and sometimes not talk at all. Their rate was different. They were fast. They were slow. Their pitch was different. And their melody was better. Their phrasing, as we need to do in speaking, your phrasing rather than speaking word for word, as you'll probably hear when I do my speech. Before I introduce our Toastmaster, if Shatish could give us in place a 2-minute update on the open house, that would be wonderful.
Hi everyone. The open house is going to be on February 13th at 12 noon in the auditorium. I actually have some flyers that we created, I'll pass these around. If you are not a Verizon employee, we ask that you take these back to your job and pass them out there as well. And we'll hang some in the building just so that we can drum up interest here as well. We are hoping guests can come, not only Toastmasters individuals, so if you know of someone who may be interested, please invite them as well. There's an email on here also where they can RSVP just so that we can have a count. And if you're interested in helping set up the auditorium that day, please reach out to me. My email, you can reach me at the VPPR email that's on the flyer as well. The other thing I had was, we spoke about, actually at the TLI last weekend, which was really great, they brought up the idea of getting business cards for our club. So we're gonna go ahead and do that through Vistaprint. So we'll have that later on. Also, there's a new LinkedIn group for our club. It's Telecom Park Toastmasters. So I encourage everyone to go out and join our club on LinkedIn. And also there's a new Twitter account, which is at TM6745Club. On there, I will go out every time we have a meeting or a new event coming up. I'll post that information as well. So if you don't have access to your email, at least you can still get the information. So feel free to follow us there as well.
Thank you. With that, our Toastmaster, Jim Anderson.
Excellent, thank you very much. But we're pretty much at the meeting. Thanks. No. Welcome. Why are we here? What meeting is this? See, because if you thought it was something else, you're going to be bitterly disappointed no matter what we did here. Well, welcome. Thank you so much for joining me today. It's bitterly cold outside. Potentially snowing later on. It snowed in northern Florida. Have you seen the sun picture? Have you seen the Welcome to Florida sign? It's all, yeah, okay. No, it's just going high. Well, it's not snowing here. More importantly, it's not snowing in the room. Instead, we're here for Toastmasters. And Toastmasters is all about you. It's all about an opportunity for you to become a better speaker. Now, some people will be giving speeches today. Yay! So they've got a real great opportunity there. But everybody has a chance to learn. Okay, so whether or not you speak today, yay? But even if you don't speak, you're going to have a chance to watch people speak. And the people who will be speaking in all their different roles are at different levels, okay? Hopefully you'll be able to see some really good speakers, and hopefully you'll be able to see some people who are just starting out. What you need to do, number one, is keep your eyes open. And number two, you need to be thinking about, hey, what works? What are they doing that's really good, that's connecting with me, that's capturing my interest? Flip side of that is, hey, what's not working, okay? Are they doing something that's distracting? Or are they doing something that I don't think I'm gonna be able to remember 10 seconds after they're done talking? These are all incredibly valuable things. So everybody in this room, when you leave today, the most amazing thing will have occurred. You will leave this room a better speaker than you came in. How is that? Is that pretty cool?
Yes.
How much would you pay for that? If so, get it out, put it on off the line. No. All right. Every single Toastmasters meeting is not just about the people who are giving speeches, but rather it's a community effort, right? It takes all of us pulling together to actually make this thing successful. I am your Toastmaster today. That means this is my meeting. You're invited to come and to stay at my meeting. But I'm not going to be doing it by myself. I'm going to have some people helping me out today. I've got a whole bunch of different roles. Let's see if I can do this in sequential order here. Accumulator. Who will be my accumulator today?
How would you need, Jim?
Joel! If you're going to be annoying and making noises, could you explain to us in some sort of feeble way why you're going to be doing that for us, sir?
My role as accumulator is to listen for ums, ahs, sos, and other filler words when you're speaking. I will make note of it, give a report at the end of the meeting. Other than the prepared speeches where I will not ding, if you hear this, please don't acknowledge it. Just recognize what it is you're doing and try and correct it as you continue to speak. Thank you.
Excellent. Good job.
I'm used to responding to the horn for accumulator. Have you switched the device?
Apparently.
The bell is the...
How's your watch here?
It's my meeting.
He's being Pixar.
I'm a well-trained dog, so I shall...
let's shake it up a little bit. Okay. Yeah. Don't live in a box or anything like that. Great. Now, posture watcher is another role that we have. Now, I currently have this one open. Okay. So if you're just going to be sitting there, if you were planning on sitting there today and doing nothing, this is your opportunity to change things around. You're here. I've got you here for an hour. Why waste your time? Why not step up and actually do something? So I've got a role available. Who would like to take it? I can only have one of you do it. Now, he's my go-to guy. I can always go to him. But does somebody else want it? Would somebody else like to be my posture watcher?
How could that be?
I already have a role.
What's your role?
I am the
table topics.
Table topics.
Oh, okay. That's actually pretty important.
How about Ken? Has Ken had an opportunity?
No.
Ken.
All right, Ken.
Well, Ken, I'm not going to force anything on anybody. You have to want it.
I want to be a posture watcher.
Do me a favor, stand up, Kev.
Ken,
do you know what the posture watcher does?
Not bad.
Hands by your side, sir. Okay.
It's on the agenda.
Do you know? Would you like me to tell you?
Sure.
Okay, first off, pick this up and honk it, because I got to hear it. And once again, cool. No shyness in this role.
Okay.
Guys, so we're going to have a bunch of people speaking today, right? Mm-hmm. Now, what we want to do is to hear the magic words that tumble out of their mouths. We want to have beautiful pictures painted in our head for them. That'll be great. That'll be fantastic. However, sometimes tragedy strikes. Tragedy strikes is that they distract us with something that they do with their body. Maybe they're making sure their eyebrows are laying down. Maybe they've got fantastic earrings that they have to double check that are still there, because sometimes those things leave. Maybe they're messing with their watch. Maybe they're messing with their rings. Maybe, like you, it's cold, so I can understand it today, okay? But okay, or maybe they're playing with the back of their chair. Anything they do with their body that's distracting. I want to hear. What do I want to hear? Gotcha.
But that's not during the planned speech.
There's only three times during the meeting that we won't hear that. During the three planned speeches. But during those planned speeches, what are you going to do? You're going to
write it down.
And then at the tail end of the meeting, I'm going to call on you, and what are you going to tell me?
Tell you what they did wrong.
There you go. Well, not wrong. Where the opportunity for them to improve is. Does that sound like a fair deal?
Yes.
Excellent. We got the two tricky propositions taken care of. What else do we have here? Grammarian. Who's my grammarian?
That will be me.
Fantastic. What will you be doing?
Today I'll provide the word of the day.
Which is?
Which is quixotic.
Quixotic.
Quixotic. You got me.
Okay.
It's both, but it does have roots in Don Quixote.
Yes.
but it's quixotic. And I actually picked this word because it was the only word that was on my SAT that I had no clue what it was.
Yes.
Or what it was. And it stuck with me since 1992. Way it means impulsive and rashly unpredictable. In a sentence, you can say, although Jack knew his job hung in the balance, he felt a quixotic need to argue with the boss. So I will check during the meeting to see if you use it. If you do table topics, we recommend that you use it. And I'll also check for good and bad language and give a report at the end.
Fantastic. That's all we have. Mr. Tim! You know, Doctor Who's a popular show. And what does Doctor Who do? He
travels through time.
And what will you be doing today,
I will
Dr.
be keeping
Who?
Time, trying to keep Doctor Who in his proper time.
Yes.
So, during the prepared speeches, I believe it's both 5 to 7 minutes for both your speech and Sean's speech. So at 5 minutes, I will give you a green light, 6 minutes yellow, 7 minutes red. Anything over that is the Dr. Jim line, where I will flash the red light like this. And at the end, I will give you a speech of the what happened. Table topics, 1 to 2 minutes. 1 minute will be green, 1.5, yellow, 2 is red. Thank you.
Fantastic. Got a quick question for y'all. What's happening on Sunday?
Super Bowl.
Who's going to watch the Super Bowl? Look at hands that aren't going.
Oh, yeah, me too.
You don't go watch Super Bowl?
I'm going to watch it.
I'm talking to the young lady.
A movie?
Probably for the commercials.
Put your hand up too. It's okay. You know, it doesn't have to be I Love Football or anything like that. You will turn the TV onto the channel, whatever it is, that has the Super Bowl on it while it's on, probably, right?
Yeah.
Along with like 69 million other people who end up in the same sort of thing. Well, that's cool. So, you know, and then you bring up an interesting point. I appreciate the segue on this one. Why will you be watching the Super Bowl? So who's gonna watch it for the football? You know, it is sort of funny. What are the two teams that are playing this year?
Seattle
and Broncos. And aren't those the two states that have legalized
marijuana?
Super Bowl. I those two states. They're there for the first half. For the second half, I think it's, you know, whatever. It's does say something, you know. Whatever, it's all good. But it's where's it being played?
New Jersey.
And what could happen?
Snow.
No matter what, it could be really cold, right? Yeah, so we'll have to, you know, see how many people we lose during the Super Bowl, right? Drinking and cold never works out that well. Fantastic. Well, I'm excited about the Super Bowl too, but maybe for slightly different reasons, because people do watch it for the football, as we talked about. Now, what's the other reason people generally watch the Super Bowl?
Commercials.
Hey, you're spending, what is it? $4 million for 30 seconds? I mean, I'll watch. I mean, you just smoke $4 million, I'm darn right I'm going to sit there and watch it. I personally get excited about the Super Bowl because of food. Does anybody eat during Super Bowl?
Yeah.
No. Do you eat basically like vegetables and fruits?
No.
No. Come on. Look, you've got basically a 5-hour window to gorge. Okay, let's be real honest about this. You're going to find every junk food you can possibly get your hand on. You're going to heat it up. You're going to sit your butt down. It's basically just scooping it in is what it's really all about, which is fantastic. That's wonderful. That's exactly what the Super Bowl is about. The game may be over, but the pounds will stick with you for about 6 months or so, and you'll have that pleasant memory to work on. So I'm excited about food. That's what I get excited about. And we should talk a little bit more about Super Bowl food, but first, how about if we have a speaker? Our first speaker today is going to be Dawn. Dawn will be giving us, from her competent communication book, speech number 6, in which she'll be working on vocal variety. So this is actually a really cool speech. For anybody who's not given speech 6 yet, I urge you to watch to see what she does, because vocal variety is a little bit of a challenge of a speech. When we say vocal variety, what is she going to do? Yell at us?
Yes,
the entire speech?
Yes.
She could do that, okay? But remember, what does she have the options to do? She can be loud, or she can be soft. She can take her voice high, and she can take it low, and I guess she can also do silence. But that's sort of it. That's what she has to work with. So we'll have to see how she does it. And the other thing I would ask you to take a look at, she's got a subject or a topic that she's picked because she thinks it works well with vocal variety. So that for everyone who hasn't given it yet, see what you think and see if you picked a good topic, and maybe you can use either the same topic or something similar to that. Before we get started, Dawn, I did ask her. I said, Dawn, you know, Super Bowl's coming up. What are you going to be eating for the Super Bowl? She said something very interesting. You know, I was expecting what, pizza or wings? She said popcorn. Popcorn. She said she makes it a special way. Now, okay, right there. You got my interest on that. So we'll have to see what the story is on that one later. But I introduce Dawn with speech number 6.
have a pet?
Toast.
Oh, good. Do you realize that 62% of households in America in 2012 had at least one pet? I grew up with a pet. We had a dog, a terrier mutt. And I have so many fond memories of my dog that I'd like to share a few of them with you. One thing that we used to do was a friend of mine and I would get the dog all riled up and we'd run around the house and try to get the dog to chase us. My sister and I shared a bedroom and we had bunk beds. And in the doorway, we had a monkey bar that was pressure fitted. And so what we would do is run around the house, get the dog barking, run as fast as we could, and then we'd decide who'd go first, and then you'd be dependent on the first person to be quick on those monkey bars, and to run up in the air, get on the monkey bars, and get on the top bunk, and the dog could jump because he was a terrier, but he could not jump that high. And so most of the time, we did not get caught by the dog. Another memory I have of my dog is when we were playing in the yard. I lived in Chicago, brick houses, close together, and in between the houses was the gangway, which connected the front yard and the street to the backyard and the alley. And we were playing in the yard, and unbeknownst to us, somebody had left the front gate open. And as we looked down the gangway with all the commotion, we saw our dog, Honey, and another dog fighting. And they were going at it and at it. We ran into the house. Mom! Mom, the dog, Honey! Honey's having a fight! She came running out, but there was nothing she could do. She went back in the house, called Aunt Mary. Aunt Mary came over. There was still nothing they can do. The dog left, and even though my dog was not hurt, Aunt Mary and Mom were concerned, and they were talking, and they were whispering, and they were deciding whether to take Honey to the vet. 9 months later, I realized, well, at that time I didn't realize, not until I was older, that those dogs were not fighting. Because the dog, Honey, was having puppies. Honey wanted to have her puppies underneath the bunk bed. And as you know, bunk beds are low to the ground. They're designed that way. And there she was, all the way in the back, underneath the bunk bed. And she was gonna have the puppies. And we waited, and we waited, and we waited. And then my dad said, I guess I'll have to help her. Oh. So there he goes, underneath the bunk bed, to assist the dog. And so with the first one, I guess she couldn't get the first one out. After that, they started coming and coming and coming. And of course, there's a runt in the litter. And so he comes out with the little puppy and it's not breathing. But we're young. We're like, oh my gosh, the dog is dead. Mom gets on the phone, calls cousin Eddie, who's a pharmacist. Okay, I'll get Joe right on that. Joe, you gotta give the dog CPR. CPR? What? Well, you don't give a dog CPR mouth to mouth. You take the puppy, push, 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 rock, 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 push, 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 rock, rock, rock. Well, he did that for probably a minute or two. And then all of a sudden, of course, the puppy started to cry, and my dad was a hero. Since I have so many fond memories of having a pet, I wanted to have that same opportunity for my boys. But I did not want all the work. And so I had a plan. They were all in elementary school. And luckily, every classroom, at least when they were in elementary school, seemed to have a class pet. And guess who took the class pet home every weekend? We had rabbits, we had guinea pigs, we had gerbils, we had something else, hamsters. And it was wonderful. We had the pet for 2 days, and then back to the classroom. The plan was working. They were having such a good time, I even enrolled them in critter camp. They loved that. For for a whole week. They got to be with their pets. They got to take care of them. They got to see them every day. It worked so well the next week. I mean, the next year I took them to Critter Camp. But they were 1 year older and 1 year wiser. And so they came up, please, can we adopt a pet? Please, can we adopt a pet? No, 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 no. Well, one of the reasons I didn't want a dog was I'm allergic to dogs, and I didn't want to sweep up all that dog hair. And my husband didn't want a small, hypoallergenic dog that he had to bend down to pet. So my oldest, who was 12 at the time, went on the internet, and he says, I'll find a pet for us. And what did she know? He comes back, and he says, how about a golden doodle? A golden doodle? I didn't even know what a golden doodle was. Well, a golden doodle is a cross between a poodle, standard poodle, and a golden retriever. Big dog, hyperallergenic, all criteria met. I'm like, oh, shoot. So my husband and I went out shopping, and while we were out shopping, the boys took each a pad of Post-it notes, and on each Post-it note, they wrote, please, 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 Mom, we want a dog, please, please, please. And they took all these Post-it notes and pasted them over the entire house, including the ceiling where they got up on the headboard and pasted them up there. Well, my husband thought this was hysterical and now has joined the group who want the dog. Well, wouldn't you know, in Lithia, there is a breeder for golden doodles. Who would have thunk? So, losing the battle to three boys and my husband, I went on the internet and started looking. And as I was reading the process to obtain one of these dogs, I realized you had to, one, fill out a puppy application, and two, in the fine print, it said it would take up to 9 months to get a dog. Well, for me, this is perfect. Nobody's read that fine print. Oh, sure, I'll put in a puppy application. Thursday, I go in, click, 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 click. We wanted a red dog, we wanted a boy dog, and we wanted a dog with a great personality. Send. 4 days later. Ring, 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 ring. Hello? Hi, you put in a puppy application for a red dog, boy, great personality? Well, we have one available. Saturday? Oh my gosh. Well, needless to say, we went, we looked at the dog, we loved the dog, and we got him. And we are happy to have him as part of our family. We're a very musical family. He obviously will not have puppies, but he is a great singer, and I'm glad that we had the opportunity to get him. Thank you.
You know, it's interesting because Donna asked the question, so what kind of pets do you have? Well, I was, for the longest time, a happy dog owner. Very, very pleased with that. But I also have a now 16-year-old daughter who at various times has decided that we needed more pets. So I'm now the proud owner of a tortoise. Quick question, anybody know how long a tortoise lasts?
Forever.
Actually about 45 years. Oh, of course, she's all done with the tortoise now. That was so last. So now I have a tortoise. But it gets a little bit worse. Because after the tortoise, she got a bee in her bonnet to have rats. You can't just have one rat, mind you. So in my house, I now have 4 rats.
Oh.
And yeah, rats get out occasionally.
Mm-hmm.
So you sit there in the room and you hear the and it's like, rat! So anyway, that's my life. Anyway, so we were talking about the Super Bowl, weren't we? Well, now, if you're going to be at home, and if you're going to be eating, do you think there's a possibility that your neighbor next door might be doing the same thing? And the neighbor next door, and the neighbor next door, so basically everybody's doing the same thing, right? You can well imagine that that causes a little bit of an impact on America, and it does. In fact, Sunday would be a lousy day if you were an avocado. Why, you ask? Why would it be a bad day to be an avocado? Well, because a lot of avocados are going to get eaten. So it turns out that Americans are going to eat 80 million avocados on Sunday. That's enough to fill a football field 12 feet deep. That's a truckload. That's more than a truckload of avocados. So, yeah, not a good day to be an avocado, but we'll work through that one. All right, we've got another speaker, my friends. Just like in the Super Bowl, there's two teams. Today we've got two speakers. Our next speaker is going to be Sean. Sean's going to be giving us a speech from the entertaining book, and he's going to be giving us speech number two. So Sean's challenge to you today is, are you entertained? I want you to think about that. Because it's not the sad book. It's not the laugh at me book. It's the entertain book. So, you know, you're all going to be writing comments to him, right? So as part of the comment, you let him know whether or not you were entertained. If I asked Sean what kind of food he was going to be serving at his Super Bowl party, you know what he said? I think you can guess. He said gypsy tears. Okay, I got no freaking clue what gypsy tears are, but I am not going to Sean's house to watch the Super Bowl. Sean, we'd like to hear your speech, man. Thank you.
I'm going to forfeit the first couple seconds of my speech to let you know something. You all received one of these wonderful competent leadership books when you signed up as a member of this Toastmasters club. As opposed to dragging these things around with you like gypsy tears in a jar, which is a good thing to have on the road, I would invite you to bring this to the next meeting and we will store it for you so that every time you do a roll or have a speech, it's already here. One less thing, right? So please bring this. We'll store it for you. So, get on to my speech. I was raised in the mountains of western North Carolina. And there we have a lot of folk tales, kind of like Aesop's fables. They're a little different, though, because sometimes they're scary, sometimes they're touching, sometimes they make you want to laugh, sometimes they make you want to cry. Today I'm going to share the story of Jim Bob and Tom Tom with you. Jim Bob and Tom Tom were two people that lived in my hometown. They were brothers. One day they were out walking along the road, and they, unbeknownst to them, were about to engage in the adventure of a lifetime. They were going to learn how to cheat death. Only one of them was actually going to learn how to cheat death. And that secret is something I'm going to pass on to you today. So Jim Bob and Tom Tom were out walking along the road, seeing if they could catch a deer, maybe a squirrel for dinner, had their rifles slung over their shoulders. So they're trudging along, and they see a storm start to come up out of the south. Well, if you've ever been to the mountains of North Carolina, when a storm moves in, you have about 2.5 minutes to find cover. Because when it comes in hard. Thunder, lightning, wind. It's really nasty. So they're trying to find a place, and they see off in the middle of the woods, only because they've lived there so long, they've been able to pick this out of the trees, because it was about 200 years old, an old cabin with a tin roof. Well, that storm is coming up. They run to that cabin. They knock on the door, see if anybody lives there. It looks abandoned. They open the door, and they get inside. Just as that rain starts to pour down on top of that cabin. If you've ever been in a cabin with a tin roof in the middle of a rainstorm, it's pretty noisy. But it wasn't as noisy as something they heard outside. They heard leaves start to crackle, twigs in the woods. Something was coming to that cabin to join them. The door opens, and a man who doesn't look like he belongs in those woods steps into that cabin. And he says, "Pardon me, gentlemen, my name is John. I'm the bell ringer in town. Can I share your cabin while we pass this storm?" Jim Bob and Tom Tom think it's a little strange that a man would be out in the middle of these woods, not dressed like he belongs there. He had on a white-collared shirt, jacket, not hunting clothes by any means. But being the country boys they were, they said, "Please, sir, have a seat. We'll wait the storm out together." Well, it started to get real dark outside as that storm was right on top of that cabin. Rain was coming down, pounding on that tin roof. The only thing that they could see in that cabin was the silhouette of John sitting on the far wall. But when the lightning would flash, it would illuminate the inside of that cabin. And they could see him there, sitting, staring right back at him. Well, they were going to be in there for a while, so Jim Bob said, "John, sir, would you tell us a little bit about this job of bell ringing? We've never heard of that." Well, John at the far wall, he takes out a little bell and he says, "Well, I've been carrying this bell for a while. I ring it to help pass souls from this world to the next." Jim Bob and Tom Tom had to laugh at that because living in the mountains, you're a little closer to the space in between this world and the next. So things like this tend to happen. You meet strange characters in the woods. They said, "Tell us how that works. We're interested. Never heard of a bell ringer like that." Well, John the bell ringer reaches into his jacket. And they can only see the dark outline of his silhouette against that cabin walls. The storm is raging outside. He pulls out a little black notebook and he says, "Well, I just opened this notebook, and the first name in it, that's the name that I ring the bell for, to help ferry them from this world to the next." Jim Bob and Tom Tom said, "That's pretty funny stuff, Mr. John the Bell Ringer. Would you tell us, please, who are the next names in your book?" And so John the bell ringer waits for the next flash of lightning to come through that window, and he looks in the book and he says, "You boys said your name was Jim, Bob, and Tom, Tom? You gentlemen are the next names in my book." When the lightning flashed the next time, John the bell ringer had vanished. Nothing but an empty wall where he was sitting. Door of that cabin hadn't opened. They didn't hear anybody running off in the woods. But it was just them in that cabin alone. Well, the next week went by. Jim, Bob, and Tom Tom thought on that experience they'd had with John the bell ringer. Jim Bob took it a little hard, thinking about how his time was coming a little sooner than he thought it might. Started thinking about all the things that he wanted to do in his life that he never got a chance to do. Started to get sick. Started running a fever. Now, in the mountains in this day and age, you can find a doctor within a couple miles, but back then there was no such thing. Sometimes it took days for the doctor to get there. But Jim Bob and Tom Tom were in that home together when Jim Bob passed away. And Tom Tom heard in the distance, echoing from the hills, the sound of a bell as his brother drew his last breath. Tom Tom knew he didn't have long either. He was the next name in that book. So he got together all of his money and he gave it to his church. He took all the food in his house and he thought, "I don't want to be here for 3 weeks dead on the floor while my food spoils, so let's have a party." In the mountains, they call such a party a hootenanny. So they all got together. The banjos were picking, the guitar was strumming, the fiddler was sawing on that fiddle. All his neighbors were there eating all the food he had, having a great time. Maybe it was a birthday party, somebody in his family. They didn't know, they didn't care. It was a chance to get together as a community. Well, that bell ringer, he rang that bell. But it was so loud that Tom Tom couldn't hear it. Nowhere could anybody in the house hear that bell being rung. And so that bell ringer, he got up on the porch and he was ringing that bell like nobody's business. But it was so loud inside, nobody could hear it. Tom Tom lived another 47 years. And here's how he did it. He was so loud in the way he lived that he could never hear that bell ringing. When someone in town needed some advice, he'd find Tom Tom and he'd be talking to him, and that bell ringer couldn't get an edge in, couldn't get his bell rung. When someone in town needed Tom Tom to work, he'd go find him immediately because he knew he was a generous man. He was willing to share the things he had. And so Tom Tom, for 47 more years, was able to cheat death. And finally, in one quiet moment, he invited that bell to ring. He chose for it. He said, "I'm done now." And that bell rang. Ferried him into the next world. So as you go about your days, if you're interested in cheating death, I suggest you do the exact same thing Tom Tom did, and you live your life so loud that that bell never has a chance to reach your ears.
Good job, sir. Thank you very much. Oh, I'm all moody now because I just heard like a really impressive story. So yeah, whatever. But you know, when I hear a story, the darndest thing happens. I become very hungry, which, interesting enough, is exactly what's going to happen to me on Sunday. So, eating food is good. Drinking beer is better. Okay, and a great deal of beer will be drunk on Sunday because, of course, we see all those TV commercials, and we'll be thinking that that's a good thing to do. And so while I tell you about beer, I would like you to take a moment to write down comments for our two speakers. Remember, it was Don and Sean. My gift to you is that everything rhymes today. You're welcome. Okay, and also, I need you also to vote. We heard two really good speeches, no question about that, but they were not equal. One was just a scooch, a little bit better than the other, and you have to determine which one that was. Anyway, talk about beer. Super Bowl watchers are going to be drinking 325 million gallons of beer. How much beer is 325 million gallons, Jim? How ironic that you should ask, because I know that. That's enough beer to fill an Olympic-sized swimming pool, which happens to hold 630,000 gallons of water, 1,938 times. Whoa. Which brings up a fascinating question. Would you watch the Olympics more closely
if they were swimming in beer.
I personally would be taping that just to see how it went, but that's just an idea. All right, we've had two fantastic speeches. This is great, but we're not done yet. I think now would be a great time for some table topics. So I would like to invite my table topics master, Jim, to come on up. Now, real quick question, can I see a show of hands of anybody who does not have a formal role in today's meeting?
You've got just sort of a visual now.
But, Jill, because it's my meeting, right? So you see all these people here? You can call on anybody you want, okay?
Okay. Thank you, this is my first meeting as an actual member, so I thought I'd jump in.
Woo-hoo!
So the theme today is questions my children ask. So if any of you have children, you know that sometimes they ask you exotic questions.
Ooh, nicely.
So the only rules are, because it's going to be a little bit easier for you, because first of all, the answers you give don't necessarily have to be correct, and you don't have the dreaded follow-up questions. The only caveat, though, is that you do need to cage it in terms that a child would understand. Okay. So the first question will go to Julia. Why do gas prices change?
I'm sorry, why?
Why do gas prices change? Why do they go up and down?
Let's see a big smile, Julia.
Big
smile. There we go.
Hello, everybody. I think I introduced myself at this point.
No, we don't even care about that. We just want to hear the answer to the question.
Okay. Why do gas prices change, you ask? Jillian, I'm sorry, Jill,
yeah.
Right? You were Jillian last week, if I remember correctly. Why do gas prices change? So you think that I would know this? I think it has something to do with the cost of the barrel of oil somewhere, whether that be in the United States or whether that be over in an eastern country somewhere. I don't know that because many times in my life I have used the company car instead of my own car. I used to be a sales director in retail, a sales director in indirect, and I was supplied with a company car and a gas car.
Oh, cool.
And so I would drive around from Hillsborough County to Pinellas County to Pasco, Hernando, Citrus County, and I could care less about gas prices. All I did was use that car to fill up the car. And it used to always surprise me. I have family who lives in Michigan, and they would come down to Florida to visit me. And other than watching TV, all they could talk about was gas prices. Oh, your gas prices are lower. Your gas prices are higher than they are in Michigan. I do think that some of it has to do with taxes, from what I know, but anyhow, I think that my family and other people who are concerned about saving money think more about the gas prices than I had thought about gas prices, because it wasn't my card. Thank you.
Stop. Word of the day.
Excuse me?
Word of the day.
Oh, yes. Gas prices... I would probably be very quixotic if I was using my husband's credit card personally to fill up my gas tank.
There we go.
Okay, next question. I don't know everybody's name, so I'm going to go with Eric because I know your name.
Hey, Jill, pointing works just fine too.
So
don't worry about it.
Why can't Santa bring me two GoPro cameras for Christmas? Well, Santa has a long list of children, and he can only give the thing that each person wants most once to them. You can't get two of the same thing. His little elves are working all year to prepare for Christmas. He's making those GoPro cameras. He can only make one for each person that wants it, because they got to make the DSi, they got to make the PlayStation 4. They're making these things to bring you. How can you ask for two when there's a kid in the other side of the world that needs one too? You'll be taking his. That won't be fair. How will Santa fulfill everyone's wish list if you're the selfish one asking for two? Impossible. You cannot get that. You will wait. You should wait and ask for that second one for your birthday. Santa is not a very quixotic person. He's a very predictable guy. He lives the same calendar year over year. He goes to the same houses. He knows who's naughty. He knows who's nice. And he's very well in the knowledge of what gifts he's going to be bringing. So don't ask for that second camera. Wait for your birthday.
He wanted two GoPro cameras. He wanted one for his dad because his dad couldn't afford one.
Jill, one more.
One more. Okay. Arnie, why is the time different in Germany than it is here?
Why is the time different in Germany? That's kind of a chaotic or quixotic question. Beats me. I have no clue. All I know is Santa Claus is broke. Right? He can't afford two cameras for anybody. He can only afford one. As a matter of fact, I stared long and lustfully at a GoPro camera just last weekend over at Bill Jackson's, where Mr. Jackson died this past week.
Really?
At 98 years old.
Wow.
I was in Bill Jackson's store when it opened down in the south side of St. Pete. And he had a box of silk parachutes and a box of silk maps of France that they used to sew inside their jackets, the paratroopers, when they came down. So now Bill Jackson's is a big, famous sports store, and he has lots of GoPro cameras there. But I didn't get any because they're too damn expensive. And that's all I have to say. Thank you.
All right, we had three Table Topics participants today. They all did a fantastic job, but one of them did a little bit better than the other two. So you've got a piece of paper in front of you. Scribble down a name, and we'll have our Jill will be coming around to collect and tally the votes for today. Oh, my goodness. We've packed an awful lot into this piece. It is fantastic. What else do I have to share with you? Oh, chicken wings. Once again, if it's not a good day to be an avocado on Super Bowl Sunday, being a chicken or having chicken wings on you would be a very bad thing also. Why, you ask? There have been some rumors of a chicken wing shortage. Quick panic now. However, we're all going to consume our own, and we'll be eating 1.23 billion chicken wings on Sunday. So please, on Sunday, get up early, because apparently you've got a great deal of chicken wings to eat. Okay? Gosh, Jim, I have trouble wrapping my head around what 1.23 billion chicken wings really would look like. Can you give me an example? And the answer is yes. Yes, I certainly can. That's enough chicken wings to fill a football field 1,083,000 times, assuming chicken wings are about 3 inches long on average. So first off, that'd be sort of gross to do. But boy, that would be really, really impressive. All right. So we had two people who put together speeches, practiced them at home, came in, overcame personal fears, and shared their speech with us. Yay, we appreciate them doing that. Now it's time for us to give back to them. So I would ask that my general evaluator come on up. Eric, and please help us return the gift to today's speaker.
Okay, everybody. We have two evaluators, one for each speech that was given, and I would like to introduce the very first, which is Ramesh. He will be evaluating Dawn's speech.
Dawn, what a great speech today. When it comes to vocal variety, there are three things you need to take care of. First one is the vocal. There are different qualities of vocal, like it should be pleasant, natural, expressive, forceful, and easily heard. The second thing is the voice. The voice should have qualities like pitch, rate, and the quality to the pulse, that is the volume, how much lower or higher that you're going to make the volume. And most importantly, the pass that you're going to make, whether it's going between sentence or between the words. That makes a lot of difference when you deliver your speech. I am today so chaotic, quixotic to give my comments about her speech. She started with a question to make sure that everybody understand adaptation of PET and experience with PETs. And she got some good response from audience, and it was, the topic was so relevant to everybody. And she started sharing her experience about her childhood, what kind of experience she had with the PETs, and basically she used her the body language each and every place to express the situation. So we can all imagine what went through that particular time, whether it was 50 years back, 20 years back, or just last week. And when it comes to the dog fight or a CPR, like push, 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 rock, rock, you can imagine what kind of expressions that went through that particular moment. It was so good. And when the word that was chosen for the moment, like, oh my gosh, she just paused for every single word so that everybody can imagine what that particular moment was suitably chosen. So overall, the topic was very appropriate. The body language at every single place, whether it was phone ringing or dog barking, or whatever happened under the bunk bed, the situation was explained with appropriate body language. The expression that was made for every situation, the vocal variety was very appropriate. And the word usage, because the word usage is very important when it comes to explaining the situation, she chose the right word. And in terms of the improvement that I would like to tell, most important one, as I was telling, the pass. Your topic from beginning to end, it was just running. Not much of, I didn't see much pass in between, slow down or anything. So the speech rate was so constant. So make sure that, you know, next time when you deliver the speech, try to pass probably for a few seconds, that is okay, and then start. And overall, the speech was really good. I liked it. Thank you very much.
Okay, everybody, my next evaluator to evaluate Sean's speech, recap. So please welcome her.
Before the speech even began with the title. The title was talking about a secret, that there was a secret. So I was intrigued, what was that secret going to be? And you brought us right into the story about Jim Bob and Tom Tom and the visitor. And this is a visitor, of course, that we all want to come to our house. Because he had a little black book. But it's not the little kind of black book we're thinking about. I loved your props. Your props with the bell and with the book. And your gestures were great with just adding emphasis to your story, using the bell and tapping on the podium to make it sound like rain. It was very dynamic. But the one thing I've always been impressed by with your speeches is your confidence. The minute you enter this speaking area, you control. You're in control. And metaphorically speaking, you're large and in charge. There isn't a moment that I think that, you know, until you leave this area, that you don't have control of the audience and their attention. And the confidence is also evidenced by your eye contact and by your posture. And you can tell that the audience is engaged by the eye contact, the laughing, and it was very, very impressive. The area, I would say, a little bit of improvement might be to use your area a little bit more than just the podium. You've got a lot of space here to move around a little bit more. Your gestures were good. I think that maybe higher gestures rather than lower gestures, and using the area just a little bit more. Those would be the two. Your pauses also. The pauses, you use pauses in a good way, I think a little bit longer would give the audience time to really think about the point. It would help drive the point home. The topic was awesome, and I really got the moral. Live loud, and you won't hear the bells ringing. Thank you very much.
That's all. Great job.
Thank you very much. Okay, everybody, please vote for your favorite evaluator. Let's pass our ballots to our table topic master, Jill.
Is that what that's doing right here?
Mm-hmm. Okay. So now I would like to call upon my functionaries to give their reports. We have our awe accumulator, Joel. Please let us know.
By all means, thank you very much, Eric. I was very quixotic going into this role, and I was not disappointed, actually, because overall everybody did a really good job. The things that I found were mostly small. Dawn did a couple of quick double clutches, as well as Catherine, just a few little double clutches in there. Sean, you had one double clutch. You switched from a they to a there at some point. Jill, you had one And Ramesh, obviously you still need to work on your ums and your ahs. Slow down, pause, take a breath. You only had one double clutch. Today was the double clutch day, I guess. That was the one key thing. Everybody else, Jim, Eric, Arnie, Ken, I don't think I heard any uhs or ahs from you when you were trying to take on your role for the first time. So good job, everybody.
All right.
All right, next I'm going to hear from my posture watcher, Ken. Please let us know your report.
Don, you kept putting your hands on the table. Believe it or not, you actually fixed your hair 3 times.
Yes. Does it look better?
It looks good. It looks good.
But beyond that, you did pretty good.
Thank you.
Jim, you touched your face and played with your ring.
Just giving you something to.
Sean, you seemed pretty amped up. You were kind of walking back and forth, and
Yeah. Some
of it was needed because you needed to get out of the way of the podium to tap your hands, but I noticed you were kind of going left to right, which I don't know how I won't do that when I get up there. let's see here. Jill, I had you were kind of moving back and forth. And Arnie did good. Ramesh, you were pretty light on your feet. You were kind of like I am after about 14 beers.
Yeah.
And that's it.
All right. Thank you very much. Our next functionary is Grammarian. Shatish, if you would please give us your report.
Sure. Overall, everyone did pretty well using the word of the day. In terms of the actual grammar, Dawn, you started a lot of your sentences with and then. And then, so just be aware of that. Sean, you said a few kindas, but it was kinda with story, so it kinda went. Juliet, you said could care less instead of couldn't care less. And Eric, you said a few gotas. That's it.
Got it.
All right.
All right, my very last functionary is our timer. Tim, if you would please let us know.
Yes, we are running a little over in time right now, so I'll make this quick. From a couple long-winded stories, but they're fantastic stories, yes. So, Shatish, with your officer report, you did a minute 32. Don, you were a little over at 8 minutes, 7 seconds. Sean, a little over 7:06, so pretty good there. Table topics, Julia, I got you at a minute 48, so you're our winner for the day. Eric, you had a minute 20. And Arnie, minute 10. Ramesh, for your evaluation, 3:44. Catherine, you're at 2:27, so perfect. Thank you.
Losing time here, I'm just going to go really quick evaluating today's meeting. Jim, thank you so much for fulfilling your role as the Toastmaster today, sending us those reminder emails throughout the week. It really helped get those roles filled. We only had one role that was unfilled today, and that's the instructor's time. They're getting started when they're already spoken for. We don't have to sit, anyone want to do this? Anyone want to do this? No. They're all done. So consider today, going to next week's agenda, finding something to do next time, and sign up. If you haven't done it before, or even if you had fun last time doing it, sign up. I'd like to hand my meeting back to Mr. Toastmaster.
Excellent. Thank you very much. Good job. Oh, Jim, please. I must have at least one more fun Super Bowl fact about food. Well, okay. But only because you really insisted. What else can we be talking about? Well, chips. Should we talk about chips? Everyone loves chips. They crunch. They're fantastic. Chips would be a bunch of different chip dips. Americans will likely eat 11 million pounds of chips. Standard NFL football is between 14 and 15 ounces, and so that should be about 12 million footballs worth of chips. And on soda, because we all drink a lot of soda, we'll spend $2.37 million on soda for the Super Bowl, and that's about enough to buy 846 tickets to the big game. Fabulous. Ladies and gentlemen, so you spent an hour with me. You came to my Toastmasters meeting. Quick question. Do you feel that you spent your time well?
Yes.
Okay. So you heard two speeches, you heard two evaluations, you saw the joy that crossed some people's faces when they got selected for table topics, because that was the best part of their day, doggone it. And that, you got to see people speak, and you got to see how they did it, and so you will be feeling a little bit better. So my job here is done. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you so much for joining me. I apologize, wait a minute. Maybe I now need to turn the reins over to our esteemed president. Oh my God, she's
going to
talk again.
I'll be very quick, Tim.
The voting results.
Jim.
Voting results.
It's my damn meeting. No, we're all winners. Are they up there?
Damn, selected.
Who's got my voting results?
Details.
Thank you very much. We will start with table topics. The winner of the handshake. The handshake of table topics goes here. Our number one evaluator today. Stop.
Eric, here's your
word. The handshake of congratulations goes to our evaluator today.
Bill.
Likely story.
All right.
That is all I had. Thank you very much.